Hi everyone. I'm sorry to hear that you couldn't hear all of my presentation yesterday. I'll just quickly take you through the slides that I did just to give you an idea of what was going on. So initially I talked about using the RRSI DED acronym in order to help with your initial management, well, ongoing management of any toxicology patient. So that's initial resuscitation, that's your most important thing up front. And then you do your risk assessment, supportive care, investigations, decontamination, enhanced elimination, antidotes, and then disposition. The resuscitation, you're going to be doing your ABC, you're going to be doing some seizure control if required, correct hypothermia, and consider early antidotes if indicated. Risk assessment, which you're likely going to be doing at the same time as your resuscitation. What agent was it? What dose? What time was it ingested? What's happened since then? And then are there any other patient factors like in kids, say, autism or intellectual delay, or if they're a bit older, you know, in the teens, ongoing suicidality, refusing further treatment, that kind of thing. And then also risks of neglect, NAI, who are the parents, are they there, who is there with them, that kind of thing. Supportive care is mostly IV fluids or midazolam from seizure management. Investigations, you may need to do specific serology, often you'll want a gas. ECG is incredibly important, and paracetamol levels are often done in cases where it isn't clear exactly what has been taken, just because you have a very long latent period before paracetamol will show any toxicity, but once it does show, is it too late? So that's why you add in paracetamol levels often. Then some decontamination, mostly that's getting it off of the patient. We don't like pump stomachs or anything anymore. We may use activated charcoal, and we'll talk about that. Enhanced elimination, antidotes, and disposition, as we said, we'll talk about briefly. With little people, they can easily kill themselves just with one or two tablets of adults' doses, just because they're so small. And there's also a few things that one mouthful of will kill. So you can divide that up into pharmaceutical and non-pharmaceutical. The pharmaceutical, there's kind of four big ones. So sodium channel blockers, so that's your TCAs, flecainide, and then your calcium channel blockers, verapamil, diltiazem, your ones which are going to lower sugar, so your sulfonylureas, and opiates as well. The stronger, the worse, obviously. So that's why Oxynorms, and it can be, you know, a 10 milligram tablet of Oxynorm could easily stop a kiddie from breathing. And then non-pharmaceuticals, you've got your organophosphates and paraquat, which are in the country but very, very tightly regulated. So luckily we don't see much of that. Very common in South Africa and in India, and that can happen a lot. Camphor is around, that's in Vicks vapor rub. Naphthalene, that's in mothballs. Eucalyptus oil is lying around the place a lot. So those ones can come in. And it may be one of those ones where you read it just on the triage on the board, because people don't know that it's so bad. So you want to do, as soon as you see it on a board, you want to go and see that patient and start your risk stratification and your RRSI DED. When you examine the patient who's had a possible overdose of any toxicological agent, you'll want to check what their general appearance is like, especially their level of consciousness. Have a look at their skin, their eyes, particularly with how big they are and how reactive they are, what their mouth is. And all of those kind of that main four things, you're going to be often able to pick up if there's any specific toxicodrome which is occurring. And we'll go a bit into the toxicodromes just now. You want to listen to their chest, make sure they're saturating okay, check their heart rate, and get your ECG early, as that's going to help with your risk stratifications. And then extremities, you want to know muscle tone, reflexes, coordination, if there's any tremor involved. Talking about the ECG, so certain medications which block different channels will cause different effects on the ECG itself. So beta blockers cause blocking of the AV node. So you'll often see prolongation of your PR, and then you see the bradycardia. So if you're looking to see whether there is toxicity, the first thing which will happen is that PR interval will start getting bigger. Calcium channel blockers will cause a bradycardia and widening predominantly of the QRS. Sodium channel blockers widen the QRS and can also affect particularly the R wave and AVR. So that might become peaked. Potassium channel blockers, classic one is sotalol, but also antipsychotics can block your potassium channels, and that affects the QT. And so the longer that gets, the more at risk you are of torsades. Luckily, a lot of drugs which prolong the QT, so things like quetiapine or something, they also cause a tachycardia. Luckily, tachycardia is actually relatively protective in long QTs. It's the ones which slow the heart rate and prolong the QT which are the most worrying. So that's why sotalol can be very worrying, because the longer the gap between your QRS complexes, the more likely you're going to have a PVC, and then you can get R on T phenomena, which can result in going to torsades. And then digoxin can either cause patients to go fast, in which part case they often get this biphasic, weird-looking QRS complex, or they can be slowed down with a increasing AV block and go into complete heart block. So toxidromes we talked about. So you can check yourselves, test yourselves. So sedation, meiosis, decreased bowel sounds, and decreased respirations. That was opioids. Mydriasis, dry skin, dry mucous membranes, decreased bowel sounds and sedation. Hallucinations. So this is your anticholinergics. So that can happen. This is one we did briefly talk about, things that you can find in the garden and things. And something like angel's trumpet, which is in the garden, which kids can find, that would give you an anticholinergic toxidrome. And agitation, mydriasis, tachycardia, hypothermia, and diaphoresis, that was your sympathomimetics. So I have seen kids take overdoses of their Ritalin, and that would give you a sympathomimetic toxidrome. Then we've got meiosis, lacrimation, diaphoresis, bronchospasm, vomiting, diarrhea, and bradycardia. That's your cholinergics. And then altered mental status, tachycardia, hypertension, hyperreflexia, clonus. This would be a serotonin syndrome, which unfortunately can occur quite regularly as well. There's a unfortunately one patient who comes in quite regularly with tramadol overdoses. Her dad's one of the advanced paramedics who's going through a lot of work with it, and he says that yeah, she can just go onto it. There's just Facebook pages, and she just DMs them, and they just send them tramadols in the post. And so obviously tramadol as well can cause its own toxidrome, often with seizures and a reduced level of consciousness. But if they're taking an SSRI at the same time, they'll be likely to get serotonin syndrome as well. Now, activated charcoal is very good at extracting certain compounds from the GI tract when it's already in there. But with kids, you don't want to give it if there's any risk it's going to end up in their lungs because they can get very severe chemical pneumonitis. So you only use it if they're presenting within 1 hour, it's a toxin that can be absorbed by it, and you're happy they're going to be able to maintain their own airway and their GCS won't drop. Otherwise, you would protect their airway before you would give it. The dose is 1 gram per kg, and it comes in pre-made bottles, but you have to make sure you shake it a lot because it all ends up going down the bottom, and that has 50 grams in 250 mils. And it can be made more palatable by mixing it with ice cream if you need to. It's effective for paracetamol, aspirin, digoxin, TCAs, beta blockers, and calcium channel blockers, but is not effective for alcohol, anything which is ions, any acids or alkalis, or pesticides. Whole bowel irrigation, very rarely used just because it's hard to give. It's not very well tolerated a lot of the time, but it can be helpful for things like particularly iron. Basically, you're giving clean prep through an NG tube almost always. They can't drink the amount that you need. And it's 10 mils per kg in the first hour, then 20 mils per kg in the second hour, and then you start continuously at 30 mils per hour, per kg, 30 mils per kg per hour. And that will flush them all the way through. If they're under five, they'll usually need to have some IV fluids running at the same time because they can have quite a lot of losses due to this. Enhanced elimination, urinary alkalization can be helpful for things like aspirin overdose. Very rarely needed to happen at the moment just because we don't see much aspirin overdose. But if it does occur, then you're giving your sodium bicarb in order to make the urine alkaline. And then weak acids like salicylates will not be able, they will ionize in the so yeah, they'll ionize in the urine and so they cannot be reabsorbed back in the distal convoluted tubule. So it traps them in the urine, basically. Other forms of enhanced elimination are things like hemodialysis and hemoperfusion, and that would be done with the patient once they get to ICU if that's required. Antidote therapy, so you can check yourself here with this. So NAC is for paracetamol, ethanol is for methanol, oxygen is for carbon monoxide, naloxone is for opiates, physostigmine, anticholinergics, atropine, organophosphates or cholinergics, methylene blue, methemoglobinemia, FitB12, or also hydroxycobalamin, cyanide, desferoxamine, iron, Saxmer is lead or mercury. Don't see that much anymore. I do remember seeing a patient who'd managed to bite the end off of an old mercury thermometer once, but they weren't poisoned. They just spat it all out. That's the thing you find a lot of the time. They've just spat it out afterwards. FAB fragments, actually digoxin or colchicine, glucagon, beta blockers, bicarb, so that's sodium channel blockers, particularly, TCAs, calcium and insulin dextrose infusions, calcium channel blockers, and dextrose, glucagon, and octreotide you'll give for sulfonylureal poisoning. So, first case was a 2-year-old who presented having drunk an unknown quantity of paracetamol about an hour ago. Basically, you want to know how much it could have been, what's the maximum dose, so you'll want to look to see what the preparation was, when was it filled, how many doses have come out of it. You want to know what investigations, and then was what investigations need to be done and when, and what treatment is required. So investigate, you'll need to do a paracetamol level 2 hours. If that's over 1,000, if it's under 1,000, you can just stop there at 2 hours. If it's over 1,000, you then perform a 4-hour level and follow the nomogram. So a 4-hour level would again be 1,000. So if it's under 1,000, if it was over 1,000 at 2 hours, but back under 1,000 at 4, which often happens with these elixir ingestions, then you don't need to worry about it. But if it's over 1,000 at 4 hours, then you'll start treatment as per the nomogram. And the treatment is NAC and 200 milligrams per kg over 4 hours, and then 100 milligrams per kg over the next 16 hours. And they need to get admitted under PEDS. Basically, the threshold dose for hepatic toxicity in kids is probably around 200 milligrams per kg. Basically, under normal situations, the most paracetamol gets conjugated by glucuronide and gets excreted in the urine, with only about 5% getting turned into the toxic NAPQI. But kids have got good quantities of glutathione available, so then that conjugates it and it gets turned into, then gets excreted in the urine harmlessly. But if you get past that kind of 200 milligram per kg level, you basically run out of your ability to conjugate it directly, and then so you get even more being turned into NAPQI, and then you'll run out of your glutathione eventually, and so that's when the NAPQI builds up and you get hepatotoxicity secondary to that. But that all takes a long time. They can be asymptomatic for up to a day, and then go start with their liver pain, hepatotoxicity, which can then turn into fulminant hepatotoxicity. And then occasionally they will develop an encephalopathy and require actual transplants, and recovery can take up to 2 weeks of this. So it can become very, very ill with it. We said about the elixirs, which is great. They get rid of it pretty quickly. Tablets, you just follow the normal protocol, taking your 4-hour level. You wouldn't start NAC unless you're out to past the 8-hour point. If people get their NAC before 8 hours, they will not get develop hepatotoxicity. This was just a note that actually this can happen quite easily, that a parent can accidentally cause multiple supertherapeutic paracetamol ingestions. It's over 200 milligrams per kg over a day, but that goes down to 150 over 2 days, and then over 3 or more days, if they're getting more than 100 milligrams per kg per day, then they can develop toxicity. And that's basically because by that stage, you've used up all that glutathione reserve that they have. So if that's the case, they're hitting that, then you measure their ALT and paracetamol concentration when you identify that. If the ALT is normal and paracetamol concentration is less than 120, you don't need to worry anymore. But if it's more than that, then you'll start NAC. You'll probably talk to a toxicologist and refer them to PEDS Med. OK, Case two, 3 year old had got into their mother's medicine box and taken some hydroxychloroquine, which is the sodium channel blocker, which can cause lots of issues, which we talked about. So it's cardiac conduction deficits and seizures, and can also cause quite significant amounts of hypokalemia. Basically, you do serial ECGs and check the cat gases for what's happening with their potassium. Luckily, this kiddie didn't need any treatment, but if you would, you'd treat the coma with intubation and sodium bicarb. The Broad complex tachycardia would be treated with sodium bicarb. Hypotension, you'd give some IV fluids and also give the adrenaline doses. So I talked about my syringe that I like to draw up for my recess vasopressors. So you're doing 1 mil of the 1 in 10,000 adrenaline. You're drawing that up and diluting it to 10 mils, which gives you 10 mics per mil, and you're going to give 0.05 to 0.1 mils per kg of that. Or if you want to just make it so it's pretty universal, as long as the kid's over 10 kgs, you can give half to 1 mil to basically all your patients above that. And if you need, that would be a nice safe dose, and then you can give repeat doses every 5 minutes until you get effect of that. Seizures, you're going to treat with midazolam. If they are appearing to be toxic, you can give activated charcoal for hydroxychloroquine. And there is some thought about giving high dose diazepam once you've intubated them, although we won't know for certain. All kids who have had possibly had hydroxychloroquine need to be observed, and those who are asymptomatic at 6 hours can be discharged. If they develop any cardiac instability or seizures, they'll need to be intubated and moved to ICU. And if they've taken more than 30 milligrams per kg, you should just manage them preemptively. 3-year-old has taken several verapamil XRs, which are the bad ones. They're all, so the XRs are all 180s or 240s, so any toddler that can kill. And because they're XR, you get prolonged toxicity with them. This kiddie was drowsy with cool peripheries and was bradycardic. Their ECG showed a first degree heart block, and probably that QTC is probably on its, sorry, that QRS is probably on its way to being a bit wide for a 5-year-old. So your resus process for that is going to be to bring them in, get some IV access, start some fluids, get your ECG, which you've done. You're going to give some calcium, some adrenaline. You're going to intubate them once they're stable enough to get through the intubation. Once they're intubated, you're going to give activated charcoal, and you're also going to give high dose insulin dextrose. So you may be able to intubate after these two whilst this is getting set up. If you don't get anywhere with these two, then you're going to need to start the insulin dextrose before you intubate. Probably that's going to be all kind of time pressured, working out what needs to happen when, because this kid does need to be intubated. We do need to get the activated charcoal down because they're going to be getting ongoing toxicity from the tablet, which is in their tummy. And we won't be able to change that until we get the charcoal down. But we don't want to intubate them and cause them to go into an arrest. So you want to be able to get them stable enough to get through that RSI. But once you are at that stable stage, then you need to tube and get the NG tube down. Case four was a 12-year-old girl who'd taken an overdose of Zoppies and Ferragamet, so iron. Was drowsy, probably mostly due to the Zoppy clone. Was a bit tacky, and had a tender puku, and this is what was shown on the ECG. Their VBG showed a lactic acidosis with a low potassium, probably due to the vomiting, and glucose is probably due to the same as well. An abdominal x-ray is what you would do in this situation to see whether there are still some iron tablets in there, and that's what you can see here. So those need to be taken out by probably gastro in this age. You'd need to discuss it. At the very little ones, it would be done by ped surg. 12, you'd need to just work out who was the best. You basically just want the person who's happiest to do it quickly, really. And that may well also be followed by some whole bowel irrigation if there's any tablets which have got past the pylorus. You want to send your iron levels and the toxic levels more than 90. Give plenty of IV fluids. They get a lot of third spacing. And start chelation treatment with desferoxamine at 15 milligrams per kg per hour. They may well need some pressure for support. It sounds like this patient was on their way to needing airway protection. And there is some debate whether if you're still not getting anywhere to give some sodium bicarb. And so that was it. But basically, yeah, if they're taking kind of between 60 to 120 milligrams per kg, that's when they get toxic. The one thing to know is that all iron preparations have got a different amount of elemental iron in it, and that's what we're talking about here is the elemental iron dose. But toxins will tell you exactly how much is in each tablet, and then you can work it out from there. This patient was obviously already showing some signs of toxicity. They were kind of in stage 3 toxicity. So you probably wouldn't need to go down the track of working all of that out. You just start your treatment and then you can work that out later. Anyway, I hope that's been helpful for you, and I will see you for the next talk. I don't know how long it is, but I'll see you then. Cheers. Bye.